On this week's episode, we talk about some of the latest news from the E3 conferences, as well as what it's like to experience the HTC Vive virtual reality. Welcome to Video Games, eh? Hello everyone and welcome to Video Games, eh? The very Canadian podcast where we discuss the latest video game news, the games we've been playing recently, and other video game related stuff. My name is Garrett May, and with me, as always, is my co-host, Josh Taylor. How are you doing today, Josh?
Garrett, I'm doing really well. Today was the first unofficial day of E3.
That's right.
Like, there were some conferences, but like not officially E3 conferences.
There's already a lot of big stuff to talk about, and we'll get to plenty of that. Josh is just too excited. He had to even bring it up just right now.
Oh, I had to. That's the thing.
Don't worry, folks. We will get to that. But I need to tell you first that you can now find Video Games, eh, on iTunes, SoundCloud, YouTube, and of course at yesguygaming.com, where you can also find plenty of video game reviews as well as every single episode of Video Games, eh? So if you're listening to this, check out our, however you're listening to this, subscribe, like, comment, check out all our content. We greatly appreciate it. Thank you guys for watching. Okay. Now with that, Let's get to the show bad. Let's go for a rip, eh?
Let's get her going.
Okay, so because of the pure volume of stuff that has just come out ahead of E3, all these major companies have had a lot of press conferences already, released trailers, EA Play is over. I think it finished, so that's done with. So we've got plenty of news from there, so I think we decided that Josh and I would each pick three items, three of our favorite, you know, most exciting items from you know, the lead up to E3 as well as EA Play. And then next week, we can kind of debrief everything that happened this week, all the full news and everything that comes out from E3. Does that sound good to you, Josh?
Yeah, that sounds good to me. I think next week we do, like, our episode can be pure E3 focused.
That's right, because we'll have all the news, we'll have everything. Everything will have happened by then.
This week will be the kind of the E3 version of the podcast where we just tease it a little bit.
That's right. So, you know, just a heads up out there, everybody, it runs Tuesday to Thursday is the conference. That's the 14th to the 16th. So if you're looking for any news and stuff, now is the time to check it out. Probably as when I release this podcast, it'll be right in the thick of it. So, but there's already been a few things that happened. So I guess we'll just alternate, Josh, with kind of our favorite things. We can talk about them.
Sounds good.
And get to it. So I'll start because I'm super hyped about this one. I really only had one thing that I was super hyped about and I wanted to see, and we saw a little bit of it already at the EA Play conference, and that's Mass Effect Andromeda.
Mm-hmm.
So they published the Mass Effect Andromeda, a new trailer for it, and it looked awesome. I mean, it looked everything that I expected the next Mass Effect game to look like. It looked like it showed me everything I needed to know, as well as a bit of hints into the story, some characters, and just it was super exciting. Did you happen to see that?
I did, but I was bummed at the lack of anything concrete. Like, I don't know what the game's going to look like yet. I mean, from the footage, it looks amazing, but that was a cinematic trailer, so the game doesn't have
definitely.
To look anything
well,
like
they
that.
Showed a little bit of gameplay, so it looks like they're going to kind of clean up. I mean, it looks great. It looks like they're going to take the appearance to the next level, which I'm super excited about. But I definitely, because that was the thing that I was kind of curious about, is what's the story actually going to be? I mean, there were a lot of rumors and what's going to happen, but the announcement trailer didn't really show anything, right?
Yeah. No, I know. It was just a lot of dev, like a lot of developers doing art.
That's
and
right.
Stuff.
And that last scene in the trailer when that woman wakes up, which you have to assume, or at least I expect, would be one of the female protagonists of the game, waking up being like, we made it.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Like, they made it to the Andromeda Galaxy, and they're there. You know, it's just a great moment. I'm super hyped about it.
Their cryopod. That'll probably be in the intro cinema scene, eh?
Yeah, no, definitely.
Unless there's a tutorial on the ship, but we'll see.
Yeah, maybe. Well, we'll see how it goes. I don't know. I'm super excited. Yeah, I guess I was a little bit disappointed they didn't show more. More gameplay and stuff like that. There was a few bits and pieces here and there that you could kind of tell, like when they group up in cover behind that thing and they're shooting off.
Yeah.
A couple little snippets like that, but still, nothing's going to bring down my hype for Mass Effect Andromeda.
Yeah, as someone who, I love the Mass Effect games, but I've never played them.
I get you. I feel you, man.
Like, but you're like, I know that they do great things for gaming, so that's good. What was I going to say?
It was probably super important.
It
was like the most profound point you would have ever made.
Yeah, it was about, I heard that EA, like their entire press conference was kind of lackluster. There was almost no gameplay footage. There was no real, other than Battlefield 1, there was no just like gameplay demos and stuff like that. They had very little even, I don't even think they had any on-stage gameplay. You know what I mean?
Listen, we'll get into what EA screwed up later. Okay, so okay, save your gripes for later.
But my thought is that EA might be doing the Fallout 4 style marketing, where instead of just like showing stuff all the way along until your game is released, you just wait till like 6 months before, and then you just dump all the info on people.
Right.
Just so that you can kind of maximize the hype train a little bit of time.
You don't get people super hyped now for a game that's going to be coming out in a year or more.
Right, like, because I'll forget.
You'll lose it. Like, you'll forget about it. Maybe that's true. Maybe they're smartening up. I mean, I did look through all of EA's stuff, and there were a couple of things on my list here, but we'll get to all that stuff. But Mass Effect Andromeda, nothing is going to bring down my hype for that game.
Nice.
Okay. What's one of your favorites, Josh?
Okay. I picked out a bunch of favorites. So I'm still
pick
like
your favorite favorites.
Yeah, I'm still whittling it down. So I'm going to start, I guess. You started with Mass Effect, so I'll start with a game. I saw the Sea of Thieves.
Oh, yeah.
That is so hype for me. Oh, my God. Like, a pirate, open world pirate game. The only thing I don't look forward to in it is that it's co-op and you need buddies or other people to, like, man the ship and do all that kind of stuff. I wish there was AI.
They might have AI. I mean,
hopefully, yeah.
We don't know.
Must they? They might not.
If you need, I'll man your ship for you, Josh.
See that? At least I have one friend.
You got one friend to man your ship for you.
One gamer friend. But yeah, it looks so cool. Like, I love the art style, by the way. The art style to me is so fun. Like,
well, it's refreshing to see because there's not a lot of games who really attempt to do open world or pirate games for that matter. There's a lot of devs who have done it poorly. But to see one that actually looks pretty good and is super exciting for what they're going to bring, I mean, it is refreshing.
Oh, yeah. I was seeing the Battlefield 1 kind of gameplay footage from EA, I'm still on Sea of Thieves, don't worry.
Okay.
But seeing the destruction from that, like I was watching, it was like the actual gameplay footage, playing multiplayer round or whatever, and you see the town that they're fighting in early in the match, and it's like sunny and vibrant and buildings are standing and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
And then like by the end of the match, everything's in ruins, there's like a burning husk of a blimp and stuff like that.
Destroyed everything.
Like, everything is just in ruins.
Yeah.
And I wish there would be some level of destruction in Sea of Thieves, like a pirate game.
Right.
On the ships. That's what
like
I really want to see.
Like, the hull gets ripped to shreds. It's, like, just floating by, like, how is it still floating type thing.
Yeah, I want to see how is it still floating, which I did see. They did have, like, damage, and there was guys patching up holes in it in the trailer. But what I want to see is, like, cannonballs hit the hull, splinters shoot everywhere, and they cause damage. Like, because that was, in Pirate Times, a big cause of damage.
Yeah.
It was splinters flying all over
and
the place.
And killing people. Well, maybe they'll have that stuff. I mean, it was still early, right? Like, it's the first we heard about that game, right?
Yeah. Anyway, so that's my first one.
Nice.
What's your next?
My next is EA had another promo clip that they showed that was hyping the future of Star Wars games. In the upcoming years, and a couple nuggets of information that we kind of knew, but just that they kind of put it into a neat package. So they're coming up with a new Battlefront, obviously. New content for Battlefront, a new Battlefront. That we kind of knew that was going to happen. I don't know how excited I am about that. But what I did hear is that there's two of their studios are doing two separate kind of action adventure Star Wars games. One, I didn't think it said what type it was. The other said it was like a third-person action-adventure game. They didn't have any details about it. They just said they were in development.
They had almost no details on their Star Wars
games. No details. But still, I mean, got me super excited. I mean, take your time, please. Like, if you do these right, this is a license that you don't want to fuck up. Seriously.
Did EA talk about Mirror's Edge Catalyst at all?
Not that I noticed.
I guess that's too like close to release to be an E3, I guess.
Whatever.
Anyway.
I was super excited about the Star Wars games. Like, the two new ones that they're going to be coming out, they had a little clip of Star Wars The Old Republic in there, which is a has a special place in my heart.
Yes.
Adding new content to that game. I love that game. so I'm just really excited to see what kind of games they're going to be bringing out. Because it has been a while since we've had kind of single-player adventure Star Wars experiences, right? Like, in years past, there were years where there was just tons of them. So many of them out there, right?
What I really liked about what they were saying, like what they were saying in their video about Star Wars, was the fact that it's anyone can kind of play their own story and universe in Star Wars.
Yes.
Like, that sounds really cool.
That is the essence, I think, of Star Wars. It's this big, vibrant universe. And hopefully they can bring something to life where we can go in and experience it in our own way, which, like, a Battlefront is a game that doesn't really bring that. You're a stormtrooper. You're a rebel. Yeah. It's your cookie cutter experience, which is fine. It's good.
It's a good foundation.
But the essence of Star Wars is that exploration, that feeling of wonder, and excitement that you want to get. So hopefully they can bring that. And I mean, they showed a little tiny clip of early gameplay footage for one of the games. Still untitled, and it was just a guy walking through a door on what looked like Tatooine.
Yeah, that really excited me, that clip.
And it looked great. I mean, it's just a little clip, so they obviously made it look the best they could. But it's just like, okay, wow, so they're actually doing this stuff, and like, maybe I can customize this guy. Maybe it's me. Maybe his fight style is, I can totally choose it. Like, just my mind was going wild with, you know, what they could do. So
I know.
Hopefully they'll deliver.
Hopefully. My other point on that is, even if they don't let me customize it, even if they just give me fixed characters and say, here's this character, this person's story in the Star Wars universe.
But it's just different.
Right, it's different, and as long as it like fits with the universe, that would be so cool. Like, sci-fi, maybe you have some political swing or affiliation and you have to do something for the Rebels or the Empire or whatever. Yeah. It's going to be fun, I hope.
Well, you got to hope they do something cool with it, right?
If anyone has the budget, it's EA. So let's,
that's right.
Let's go EA.
That's right. I know we hate on you a lot, EA. Yeah, but you've got the Star Wars license. Do it well, please.
As much as I hate you, I'm still cheering you on. Like, you can still do a good job.
There's a couple of your studios I'm cheering on and a couple that I'm giving the finger. So, okay, Josh, what's your next point?
For my next one, Dishonored 2.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so Bethesda kind of had their pre-E3
That conference. Was their big thing, was Dishonored 2.
Yeah, and it's my big thing. So when Dishonored 1 came out, I was interested in it from the commercials and the trailer. Then I got it, and I never beat it or played it.
Well, if you're a frequent listener to the show, then you know that one week Josh went back and beat it, and we had talked about it fully in one episode.
Exactly. So I ended up eventually playing it and beating it, and holy crap, it's so fun, like Dishonored 1. And then they were showing footage of Dishonored 2 at E3, and I was like, wow. This is going to be just a better Dishonored 1. And that's exactly what I want. Is like,
well, that's story. A sequel. That's what you want in a sequel.
Yeah, new story, more, better, fluid mechanics. Like, let's go. That's going to be so fun. Yeah. And the fact that they've emphasized numerous times that there will be ways to beat the game without killing anyone, and better ways for you to play, like, stealth playthroughs. Because that's the way I love Dishonored. I played Dishonored. I think I mentioned it. Like,
you didn't kill anyone.
I didn't kill anybody, yeah. So... Well, that's going
to
fun.
So they're staying true. And I think the one little point that they made sure to make is that both protagonists or both main characters are going to be voice acted, which is different from the first game.
Which is the first game you have no voice.
So you're going to have a voice this time.
I'm down for that, too. I'm down for my character.
Did you play as a girl in the first one, or it was a guy?
A guy, Corvo.
Oh, okay. Yeah. But I guess there's a girl in this one, too?
Yeah, I think she's what they originally advertised as was the main character.
Oh, okay.
I forget her name, though. Emily, I want to say, but I don't know.
We're too hyped to remember little details like that.
Yeah, names. Come on.
Yeah, forget that.
Next.
Okay. My last topic was that from Bethesda, again, they made an announcement that Fallout 4 is going to get virtual reality support.
Or that is
compatibility,
gonna be nuts.
Which
that is
nuts. I was... spoiler alert for later in the show, I have a virtual reality device.
You got it?
The HTC Vive.
It arrived?
It arrived. So today they're like, Fallout 4 is getting virtual reality support on the HTC Vive. That's the they said getting virtual reality support, and I was like, okay, on the HTC Vive. Yes!
Yeah, that's so sick, man. I have to come over and play that right away.
So hyped for that, because I was like, okay. We'll talk about it at length later in the show, but this is incredible technology. What it needs is an awesome game. Mm-hmm. It needs an awesome game. And so if Fallout 4 can be that experience for this virtual reality to get the ball rolling, I'll go through and play Fallout 4 again. I'll play all the DLCs, everything. I'll do it all again because it'll be so worth it.
I think what VR needs is like great open world massive games.
Right.
And Fallout 4, like, what's better, right?
Well, and if they do it well, right? Like, if they stay true to what the controls and what the VR can do, like, if they don't limit it in any way, then it's going to be really special.
You have the Vive comes with the two controllers,
right?
That's
right.
That's going to be cool too.
It's going to be insane.
Yeah.
But we'll get to more VR later in the show. For now, Josh, let's finish off EA3 and EA Play hype news with. Well, your last or last two topics. We got time. We can talk about this stuff.
I'm going to bring up two. First, I want to bring up...
I'm out of topics. That were my three hypes, so...
Okay. Well, I'm going to bring up one that you can share an opinion on.
Let's go.
Gwent.
Okay.
The Witcher 3 card game.
Yeah.
So CD Projekt Red announced that's their next kind of release.
Mm.
And I'm, like, super excited because from the trailer and the guy talking on stage, they mentioned that there's going to be changes to the mechanics, so it's actually going to be... kind of more balanced and more playable against other human beings.
Right. Well, it makes sense.
Yeah, like they had to do that.
Like it was a game within a game, so when you're going to make it a standalone game, you fix it up a bit, make it balanced at least, so you're not, you know.
And they can expand on it, add way more cards and all that stuff.
Well, and Gwent was an awesome game, incredible game for a game within a game.
Right, like it's not even the game. You're supposed to play it like a little and fuck off.
That's right.
But everyone loves it, and I'm one of them. So
One thing I gotta say about the Gwent though is that it is gonna be an Xbox Microsoft exclusive.
Right.
Okay,
but that's a thing we haven't mentioned yet, but Microsoft announced that Xbox One and PC are basically the same now.
Strong.
Like yeah, you can have your save on your Xbox One and then just sit down at your computer and play it.
Yeah, that's strong.
Or vice versa,
I mean that's great for Xbox. I mean PC users won't really be affected by any of that crap. But the PS4 and console users definitely will. Like, you know, I know there was a strong section of the market that was only PS4 users.
I know.
Right? Like, you can't play some of these high-resolution games on a PC unless you got a beast of a PC, which, you know, there's a lot of gamers out there who don't have them. So I'm sure there's half of the console gamers who are like, the fuck? Like, where's our Gwent?
I know. Well, if you get an Xbox One, you can also get the new Xbox One, Scorpio. So that should drive the price of... like older Xbox Ones, like down significantly, right?
Yeah.
So hopefully that happens, and then everyone can kind of.
Well, I know I'm not gonna get an Xbox One.
Ever?
Like I don't see the point at this point, especially if they're combining it with the PC.
Well, I think the point for a gamer at like this me. Point becomes once they get like a backwards compatibility for all the Xbox 360 games, or at least like a majority of them, then you can start playing. Your Xbox 360 games on your computer through the backwards compatibility feature, which is like, holy mackerel. Now I'm playing Red Dead Redemption on PC, and technically I can mod it if I'm good enough at hacking or whatever.
Yeah.
At modding. Like, that is...
No, Microsoft is doing good stuff with that. I just really don't like to see big releases have exclusives.
Yeah, you know what same. I mean...
Especially when they don't need to.
Right, like a card game should be on every console because it's not incredibly...
That's right.
Like, hardware dependent at all.
Like, just hanging Sony out to dry with that one.
Yeah, that is kind of lame. But at the same time, whatever. I don't mind because I do have a PC.
Yeah, true.
Anyway, that's one, and now another one.
Yeah, hit
Titanfall,
me with it.
Titanfall 2.
Did see that.
That really excited me.
It looked good, though, didn't it?
Like, I didn't get... I played the beta of Titanfall 1.
Did?
Yeah. And I wasn't a huge fan because I'm not a big fan of multiplayer games, first-person shooters either.
Yeah.
But, man, they showed the single-player trailer for Titanfall 2, which looked incredible. I'm down for a story. I know they're going to make me catch feelings for this giant robot, and then he'll probably die or something.
Yeah.
Or explode.
Something.
But, holy, man, that looks so fun. And the way they show the multiplayer combat in
It looked Titanfall really 2, fucking cool, is what
yeah,
it looked
like,
to me. It looked
there's
like...
guys never touching the ground.
Yeah. Because, like, Call of Duty Black Ops 3 was a game that had some mobility in it. You could run up walls, double jumps, and things like that.
Yeah, like, but a little
this
bit of
is on. This is like Call of Duty, because it looked exactly like Call of Duty, but just on steroids.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it's like jumping through the air, these hook shots, robots and shit,
the
running
hook
like
shots.
Just looked crazy. You could get so good at something like that. I mean, yeah, a little bit intimidating, because you hop online just on a deathmatch game and
yeah,
you get bodied
get
by some random guy who's like the best in the
it's
world.
Amazing.
Yeah. Because you're
but
not.
I'm excited for that. I really actually want Titanfall to have a pro scene, because the plays that would happen,
yeah,
like
that's
that
true.
Kind of thing.
The highlights on something like that? Oh, man.
Yeah. Like, I already see crazy Battlefield, like, whatever,
yeah,
Battlefield highlights.
Like, guys jump out, snipe, then hop back in their plane or something like
that. Or in the other guy's plane, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
But, like, I'm excited to see that with Titans.
That's
Can you imagine?
Yeah, man.
and the like, the chain shot, whatever.
It did look really cool.
It's going to be incredible,
I think.
It did look
really, really cool. Both single-player and multiplayer on that, too, actually, yeah.
Yeah, and honestly, that's what's going to... I'm going to get it, hopefully, potentially, because of the single player.
Right.
I wouldn't get it if it was still multiplayer only.
Yeah.
But they added single player, which is what me as a gamer wanted. They
Perfect.
Listened.
Perfect.
And now they've done that.
Well, they made a sale.
Exactly. That's
on
that's what
buddy.
They should be up
Good
to.
Good for them.
One more thing I wanted to mention
mm-hmm.
was... What was it? Who have we not talked about? Oh, Ubisoft had a press conference.
Ah.
There wasn't much that excited me except for the game For Honor.
Yeah,
I don't know if you've heard of that.
That was firing me up. I put that on my top five anticipated games of 2016. I'm looking forward to that one for sure.
Yeah, I'm definitely excited for that. Just because it looks so visceral and like, it looks like when you hit a guy, it almost looks like you feel it.
Yeah.
Like nothing looks like it's light. You know what I mean?
Oh,
everything
yeah.
looks heavy.
Oh, yeah.
You hit, that excites
oh,
me.
Oh, yeah. No, that's
anyway.
Good. Yeah. Okay. So are we done with that news? That's our E3 and EA play hype for now. Listen, if you hear us talking about this stuff and there's something that you think we missed, you think that's super exciting that you want to let us know about, please feel free. Hit us up on the YouTube comments, hit us up on Facebook, anywhere, find us, Yes Guy Gaming, let us know your thoughts. We want to hear it. That's what this time of year is for. It's about getting hyped for your favorite games. So and that's what we're doing. So but we want to hear yours as well. So definitely let us know. But with that, our coverage is not quite done. We're moving on. To what is EA screwing up this week?
And they are in the limelight this week.
They're in the limelight. So,
perfect opportunity to fuck up.
Well, yes. I've got to admit, their press conference, pretty cool.
I didn't actually see the live EA press conference. I only saw trailers and news about
it. They had a lot of stuff to show, right?
I heard it was like kind of cringeworthy is what I heard.
Well, I saw some of the presenters, and the presenters were, I thought, kind of poor.
That's what the trouble with gaming, though.
Yeah.
Like, that's just the people in my industry. We're all like that.
Yeah. So, whatever. It's fine. Not a big deal.
Right, like, I don't expect it. And it shouldn't... That won't affect the games, so I don't mind.
The Star Wars thing I liked. The Mass Effect thing I liked. But there were a couple things that I think they definitely screwed up on. The FIFA stuff, I thought, looked a bit strange. I don't know if you watched the FIFA... Maybe you're not a FIFA gamer, but... I watched some of that FIFA stuff, and it was like, you progress through the story as this one character, and...
That's the My Career.
Yeah,
whatever.
So are you... It was unclear if you're actually playing as this guy, or if that guy is you, which it was super worrying to me, because NBA 2K16 did this. They screwed this up. They made you this specific character that you couldn't really customize that much to be yourself.
Right.
Which I was like, don't do that. These people play this game because they want to... Be the star. Don't give them an identity. Let them take their identity.
But they've given them a voice actor, so you can't just like custom your own guy to be 6'8", 400 pounds, and black, and then have it be a white voice actor who's like 5'2".
No, I get that. But then have two or three voices and lessen the dialogue a bit so that it can spread to more people. Yeah. Because, so for example, the only example I have to go on is NBA 2K16. Because in NBA 2K16, the only real example of this that I have to go on is they kind of screwed it up. They made it this voice actor, and the only really guy at suit, you had a twin sister who was black.
Okay.
Right? So I plug in my white guy, try to make him look as much like me as possible.
Your adopted twin sister,
and,
you mean?
And it's like, I get in this game, my mother's black, my dad's black, my sister's black, and I'm like, I mean,
what?
This is fine. But like they're talking
so you're
about,
the adopted
they're talking about how that we were in the womb together, that we share blood, and I was like, okay,
No, we don't.
We don't. I know what you're trying to get at. I appreciate it, but I should have just changed the color of my character's skin. Like, you know, so I saw that. It made me worry. But that's not the biggest gripe that I had with EA's conference. Where the hell was NHL 17?
Well, did they cover every sport except for NHL?
They covered Madden, FIFA, no NBA Live that I noticed anyway.
I think they're like folding that division.
Whatever they're doing with that, but no NHL 17.
Yeah, how do you leave out NHL? Even if you, like, it's the Stanley Cup playoffs just ended last night.
Yeah.
Like, Pittsburgh just won the Stanley Cup. Just mention it for 5 minutes. It doesn't have to be like a centerpiece of your show.
Well, or just show the Vision trailer that you've already released again.
Yeah.
Like, just let people know, yeah, we're making the game. Now I'm going, okay, they didn't show it at all. This is a clear omission. So
yeah, which,
what, do they have nothing to show?
That tells me that it's going to look exactly like NHL 16.
It's going to be the same damn thing.
Yeah.
You know it. And it's just like, okay, like, if it's going to be the same, I at least wanted to see something. Like, you know, something. Give me a taste. There are people out there, and maybe this is a smaller portion of the sports gaming community, but there are people who play these NHL games. A large group of people buy them every year, especially Canadians, just because it's NHL. There are people who own systems just for NHL.
Yeah, like Canadian people. Right. I know them.
And right, and we know them well. We are those people. I bought the NHL games from NHL 2004 till 2016. Yep. I have them all. That's a lot of years. Like, I want to see something. This is the time of year where you say, hey, fans, this is the cool stuff that we're working on that's going to be coming out this fall. Get excited. Pre-order.
Especially because EA had their own conference. So they weren't limited by like E3 scheduling.
No.
They were just not talking about it.
You scheduled your own thing and you clearly omitted a major game that people expect. Where is it? And so now what are you going to do? Okay, so now we're going to come up with a trailer. Like when?
Who knows, man?
You're just going to release the game? No hype? Like,
yeah.
We don't care about NHL. Like, I'd be curious to see what the sales numbers are between the franchises. I'm sure FIFA and Madden sell better.
FIFA, Madden, and... Oh, sorry, I was going to say 2K, but that's not EA.
Not 2K, but I'm sure 2K sells really well. But I'm sure FIFA and Madden sell better than NHL.
Yeah.
But I'm sure NHL sells better than some of their other games.
What do you... Like, give me one example.
of a game that NHL sells better than?
An EA game that NHL sells better than.
You put me on the spot, Josh.
See, I think that's tough. I think it's probably one of EA's lower selling titles. Just because their market for NHL is strictly Canadians who are hockey fans.
Listen, if it's about the Canada thing, if it's about us being Canadians, you can go fuck yourself, EA.
It's not about us being Canadian.
No, I think it is, Josh. It was an American conference. They're like, you know what? Those Canucks up north love themselves some good old hockey, and we're going to keep them waiting for it, eh?
And they don't even get... like the internet, so they can't watch the live stream, so they won't know that we didn't.
They'll be up there in their igloos. They'll be playing real hockey. They don't care about the cyber hockey.
Yeah, they read the weather today for Canada. It's like 28 degrees. They didn't notice that it was Celsius. They're just like, that's so cold.
It's
no one's watching.
Cold. No one's watching. That just pissed me off big time. So, come on, EA.
EA had that screw up. EA's going to have more. Or they already did, and we haven't heard it yet.
Do you have another screw up for EA that you noticed?
I don't yet, but I will.
Oh, we will. We will. But that was just the one thing that was really getting on my nerves this week. So I think we're done with that, eh?
I believe we are.
Done with what EA screwed up this week. Okay, moving on
okay.
to everybody's favorite segment, Worldwide Renowned. This is now the Worldwide Renowned segment. Nobody else no other podcast does this. These are our Steam Picks of the Week. Josh, you love this segment.
I do love this segment, Garrett.
Do you have a Steam Pick of the Week, or do you not?
I'm just browsing Steam right now, so why don't you take the
last minute Steam Pick of the Week?
Yeah.
Okay.
There's
mine
a couple.
Somewhat more prepared. Okay. Yeah. So mine Steam Pick of the Week is Gloria Victis. So Gloria Victis is a MMORPG with an emphasis on realism, set in a low fantasy medieval open world. Enjoy skill-based, non-target combat, open PvP with territory control, deep crafting system, and player-driven economy, all that served with beautiful graphics and immersive atmosphere. So this game follows suit in a line of a lot of games who have tried to tackle this kind of open-world, medieval-style MMO game where people get together and play.
But is it also like survival?
I don't think it's as survival-based as it's a little bit more combat-based.
Okay.
It's an MMO style, right? So you have your weapon bar on the bottom, and you've kind of got your skill-based ability. So I guess there'll be a dodge, shield, and attack. But what really struck me about this game is it does look quite good. Because a lot of these games have looked terrible. Like, looked really blocky, and the animations were crappy. And this one just entered early access, but it looks really good.
Huh.
Like, when you look through some of the screenshots and some of the gameplay, like, it looks smooth already.
Like, do the animations look good, or does it kind of look like someone... Like, does it look like the animations are motion capture, or does it look like they're programmed animations? Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, it doesn't make sense. No, they're definitely, it looks like they're programmed. But, I mean, the graphics are good enough, and it's smooth enough. It's not like a blocky kind of movement that it looks... I was impressed. I was like, okay, wow, somebody's taken the time to really take one of these games and make it look great that, you know, people... It does stand out. That's you know...
Yeah,
that's going to be the difference for a lot of people, myself included.
It looks good, and it says there it has mostly positive reviews, which is a good sign, because most of these types of games, as soon as there's a little bit bad about them, all the reviews are
Because there's a lot of them, and that's kind of what stood to me about this game. I know there's a ton of games like this, like Mount & Blade, there's some other ones, Life is Futile, that's another one. Like I haven't played those, but I just even think about off them off the top of my head.
Okay, I can vote for Mount & Blade is one of my more favorite games.
No, it's great.
Yeah.
Not saying those are bad, but I just mean, this is a game that's kind of taken that same thing, tried to up the multiplayer, and it looks good, which is surprising.
That is the big surprise.
It's surprising. It's an MMO, and it looks decent.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, like there's a lot of foliage, and like the textures look pretty good.
Good for them.
Yeah. All right.
That's my Steam pick of the week, Gloria Victis.
All right, mine is Zombie Party.
Zombie Party.
Yeah. Zombie Party is a retro rampage of fun and over-the-top action, while still giving players a deep and engaging action RPG roguelike experience. Huh. Go on a time-traveling adventure or delve deep into procedural dungeons full of gold, loot, and secrets, online and local multiplayer.
Okay.
Huh. So, from what I can tell, this game is like... Oh, how do you even describe it? It's exactly what it says. It's an action RPG roguelike. You have a character, you go through your adventure mode, you can play with co-op like buddies.
Yeah.
You can kill things. It's like the top down. It looks like Enter the Gungeon, if you're familiar with that.
It does.
So yeah, and there's like chaos going on
the
screen.
It looks intense, man.
Yeah, and so full of colors.
Yeah, it
like,
looks like
holy
there's so
mackerel.
Much stuff going on here.
Yeah. There is just a lot of
like
stuff.
Like blood, guts, like bullets.
Bullets.
There's all sorts of crap going on here.
Like 1,000 enemies on screen.
Nice.
Holy, but the reviews are all good. The gameplay looks kind of fun if you're into that. And it looks like there's actually a lot of depth because there are randomized dungeons, like it said. And I don't know what it means by time traveling. I haven't seen much on that. But it looks like there's a lot of depth. It even says here you can mod your guns. You can buy new guns and like change them and do all that stuff.
I'm not boss a huge fights. Fan of roguelites.
Me neither.
I don't like dying. I mean, some people are gluttons for punishment, but I mean, if you're into that kind of stuff, I'm sure you love those types of games.
Yeah, I agree with that. I'm not a big fan of roguelikes because, again, same with the dying thing. I get attached to my character. I don't want to have to go start a new character.
Yeah, I don't like to die.
Just like, I'll die, but I don't want to like, oh, that's everything gone, rip.
Everything gone. Yeah, I can't handle that.
As a gamer with limited time, I don't have time to go through it all over again.
No, I have no time. I have no time for that.
See, I would like to see a game that's a roguelike, like as an option.
Oh, optional roguelike.
Yeah.
Like you can either die,
you can die and respawn, or you can die and start over.
Well, maybe they have that in Zombie Party. Well, but you can upgrade your stuff, right? That's kind of why it's the light part of rogue light.
That's true.
So you don't actually lose everything. You just got to start again.
Yeah.
Zombie Party. Josh's Steam pick of the week. That was a quick Steam picks of the week. I think we're just too hyped about E3 to really be psyched about Steam right now. We're looking ahead.
Can I pick one like from E3 Steam pick of the week then?
Is it
like
out?
It just got announced and then came out at the Ubisoft.
Yeah, hit me with it.
Okay, it's called Trials of the Blood Dragon.
Trials of the Blood Dragon. Out now.
So it's, Yeah, no, so it's a fusion between Trials, like that motorbike game from the side perspective where you like ride along the path.
Oh, paths. Yeah.
Yeah, and the Far Cry Blood Dragon. So it's that motorcycle gameplay, plus there's like space now, there's all kinds of crap.
Okay.
But in the Far Cry Blood Dragon kind of universe, so everything's like 80s, 8-bit, very retro looking and over the top with tons of explosions and... It just looks like a ton of fun.
And they just announced that yesterday? Today?
They announced that today. And there's a very short section of the Ubisoft press conference, and they just said, that's out now.
Go get it.
Yeah, go get it.
And everybody probably went, woo, yeah, I love that.
Yeah. And now on Steam, there is one negative review.
That bastard.
And all it says, oh, and this is actually relevant news for people who might be interested, is it just says, Uplay. Which tells me that. So you buy it on Steam, but then you still gotta, you'd click play on Steam and it would open up Uplay and it would go through Uplay, and that's kind of annoying.
Brutal. Yeah. Terrible pick, Josh. One bad review, it means it's terrible.
Terrible pick.
Terrible. Well, those were our Steam
picks of the week.
Just a reminder that Video Games Day is brought to you by Yes Guy Gaming. Check out Yes Guys Gaming's website or YouTube channel for video game reviews as well as every single episode of Video Games Day. So head over there, like, subscribe, share, and do all that great stuff. We greatly appreciate any and all support here on Video Games Day. And on that note, let's get back to the show. Josh, we're going to talk about what I've been playing this week. No offense,
yes.
Yours can wait, because I'm super hyped about the HTC Vive virtual reality device. It came in this week. I set it up. I'll tell you a little bit of an anecdote here. It
came in,
had no idea when it was going to come, because I ordered it 2 months ago. They finally shipped to Canada, eh? Thanks so much, guys, for making it, for getting it to me. Now they're saying ships in 2 to 3 business days. Well, thanks. Why'd I order back then? Anyways, I needed a new graphics card.
Oh, no.
Right? So I went and bought one, a nice one.
What'd you get?
Good enough. It's the 980.
Dude, that's a sick one.
980.
Yeah, GTX, that's a good one.
980. I think the 980. It could be 970 or 980.
You should definitely get the Witcher.
I know there's a big difference, but anyways, I got it, and it's big, right? And I'm like,
yeah.
So I open up. The one that was in at the time was dusty as fuck. This tiny thing, I ripped it out. I'm like, how's this thing going to fit in here?
Like this big new graphics card.
So I'm like fiddling with it, just trying to sneak it in there. I finally get it underneath all these cords, right? Because I'm so nervous to fuck up anything in this computer. This is my baby. It's my life, right?
Did you build that computer?
No.
Okay.
Didn't build it. So yeah. I bought it. But anyway, so I sneak it in there, and I try to put the thing back on, and it won't shut.
It won't shut, eh?
It won't fucking shut. So I'm like, you know what? No. I refuse. I refuse. So I like press it down, screwed it in. I was like, done.
And it's like,
so it's right here, but there's like a bump in it where these cords are because it's a big monster. Anyway, so set up this virtual reality device. I'm in the basement. The ceiling's right here. Like it's low ceiling. This is one of the most incredible pieces of technology that I have ever seen in my entire life.
It's cool, eh?
Let's just put that out there. I know that's high praise.
Have you ever played like with the Oculus or anything before?
No. I never tried anything else. So
you've never done VR before.
So the VR is the VR. I don't want to say I expected it, but you'd seen it, so you can imagine what it would be like. And you step in, you don't quite understand what it's like until you experience it.
Oh, not at all.
You don't, like, you can't explain it, what it's like being in VR. It's 3D, 360, but there's another element in there to being there that you just can't explain. It's incredible to be there.
Yeah. Like, I played Elite Dangerous on the Oculus Rift way back when.
Yeah.
I still do, but I don't play anymore.
Mm-hmm.
But holy man, like, you're suddenly in space. Like, it's not like I'm playing a space video game and it's really realistic. Like, I'm in space.
Yeah, you're there.
Yeah, like, you're there.
But
it's different.
What really separates the HTC Vive from the Oculus is because the headset, I would expect, are the same.
Similar. I think the Vive's better even in that.
Though. Right. So you got it. They're the same type of thing. Like the 3D, maybe it's better quality with the Vive. Maybe it's not. Who knows? But the controllers that come with the HTC Vive, these things right here.
Are they like really good?
These are incredible. You can probably, if you look closely there, I've scratched a few times on my ceiling. But oh, and here's the headset too, right here for our YouTube viewers. You can see, it's right here. Here, maybe I'll put it on.
It looks it looks so future, man.
It's like, yeah. My girlfriend gets all scared when I wear it. She comes in, I'm like, ah. But the motion controls are incredible.
Yeah.
The amount of sensitivity and smoothness that they have is incredible. So I have a few games for it, but the first one that I played was Job Simulator. It comes with the package.
Nice.
Job Simulator. And there's four things. You'd be a cashier, office worker, car mechanic, or a chef. So I started being a chef, and like you're in a kitchen. Like you're there in a kitchen.
Right, like you reach for something, and you might actually knock something over in real life.
Well, no, you got to clear your space, right? And they actually do a really good job of keeping you in your play area, because you map out the play area with the controller. You trace it, right? So that you have this box. So when you're ever getting close, there's a wall, like a wall that comes up.
Like a VR
like
wall?
Like a VR that wall like, that comes up. It's like, hey, watch out. So you're like, okay. So you stay in your play area. But interacting with objects in this virtual reality is incredibly well done. Like,
really?
You put your hand where it looks like it is. You pick it up, and it's in your hand. You can't really feel the weight of it, but it feels like it's in your hand. Like, I picked up an apple in my left hand. I reached over there, and I, like, kind of gave a bit of a toss. I flew over, caught it in my right hand.
No way.
Like, in this, you know, it's like, whoosh, boom, drop it in the blender, pick up a cup, you know, fill up this thing. So, like, you're doing all these things, and it feels like you're actually doing it.
Like, that's crazy.
And I know I'm saying that, and you're like, oh, yeah, it feels, But, like, for people who have never tried something like this, it's you can't truly understand what it's like until you actually experience it. It's incredible.
I would say if you're still a naysayer of VR and it's like possibilities and it being
come over. You're invited to my house. Come over. Yeah. Try it out. I'll show you. It's incredible.
Like that's the thing is you have to try it. And once you try it, it's incredible. Like I was watching the Ubisoft press conference today and they had a bunch of Star Trek actors play the new Star Trek VR game that they announced.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. But all of them, as soon as they put the headset on and then like they're on the bridge of the
Enterprise.
The Enterprise. Wow, that was embarrassing.
They're like, whoa.
But as soon as they were there, they're all like, oh my god, like this is nuts.
I know. So. Yeah, so that's the initial shock of it is being in those places. But these motion controls, man, I'm telling you, this is next level stuff. And really the only thing that I'm disappointed about the system is that the games haven't quite caught up to the technology yet.
Right.
So it's basically a lot of demos and arcade style games. Now, a lot of this stuff is really fun and works really well. But And I know how intensive it is to make something, like to develop something for this system. But that's what I'm waiting for, is some of these quality games.
Well, I'll be honest. The Ubisoft conference, they had a VR game that's like you fly around, and it's like team-based flying competitive game. Mm-hmm. And they were doing like a capture the flag. But everyone plays as an eagle or something, and they were in Paris.
Right.
And like it looks so good, and the way how smoothly you can navigate the world.
No, and I'm sure the games that they'd be showing off are those types of games. Like, I think we can expect to see that kind of stuff coming out in the near future. It's probably the best game, in my opinion, that I've played. I've played probably five or six. The best game that I've played, in my opinion, is a game called Vanishing Realms. I don't know if there's any viewers out there who have this virtual reality, but this game is an RPG where you kind of walk through a dungeon, and there's enemies in this dungeon, and you use a sword and a shield and a bow and arrow to fight these enemies. You can pick up gold, there's keys, there's puzzles that you've got to do to navigate your way through this world.
And wow,
it's incredible. I was playing, so I beat the game last night, and the final section is like a gauntlet, right? You have to go through a bunch of enemies, so it's just fighting. And that is by far the best part. It was so immersive. The most immersive experience that I've ever had playing a video game.
Like, yeah, you have to turn around and fight guys and like, dodge their attacks and jump out of the way.
I feel like I'm Russell Crowe in Gladiator. Like, are you not entertained? before the battle, like, you're waiting. Like, this last area, you're in a thing and they open the doors to get into a Colosseum-like room where you fight a bunch of enemies. So I'm, like, waiting there. I'm like, you can smash your sword against your shield.
And, like, make a noise?
It makes a noise. So I'm like, yeah, let's go. Get fired up. And so I get out there and I rush out. I'm like, you know, and then soon I got pretty bold because I was like,
feeling pretty good.
Because the shield, you actually hold the shield up in front of you and they hit it. It doesn't do, you know, you got a shield. But I was like, you know what? That's too easy. So I pulled out a sword and then you get a magic wand or something, like a staff. And so I was using that to deflect attacks because you actually have to flick it to deflect the attacks.
Yeah,
and then you use the sword to attack. So it was way more active, right? So I'm like deflecting. Like you should have seen me right here. I was just like going nuts.
That sounds nuts, man.
I'm just getting sweaty thinking about it right now.
Yeah, I'm jealous, man.
No, you'll have to try it out, man. It's incredible. And, you know, I look forward to what they can do. And that's why we were talking about Fallout 4 earlier. If they can bring Fallout 4 and do it well, like in the same kind of level that some of these other demos and arcade-style games have in the VR, this is going to be an incredible experience.
Oh, yeah.
Because holding a gun with this controller...
Oh, right, it looks like it's built for holding guns.
It's a gun. Like, you've got a gun in your hand. Like, bam. You know, like you're holding a gun. So, like, I bought a game called Hot Dogs and Hand Grenades or something.
Okay.
And it's just a shooting range, pretty much. So you just go on a shooting range, you pick your gun, and you shoot targets.
Okay.
But you pick up these guns, you got to load them, you pick up the cartridge, slide it in the bottom. You got to pull back the, I don't even know what it's called. Then you got to turn the safety off.
The slide and the safety.
Aim, and you're shooting, and it's right on. Like, I'm even closing one eye to, like, try to aim, and it's working. Like,
it is, you have two eyes.
Yeah, that's what it is. So I'm like... Oh, it's just incredible. I can't say enough about it.
How's the recoil? How do they handle recoil?
No
because
recoil.
You can't they can't make your hand like do this.
No recoil.
There's no recoil, eh?
No recoil.
Interesting. Is there at least like a vibration? Is there a vibration in that?
Yeah, vibration. All right. There's sensitive vibrations too. I think there's some sort of technology in the headset as well that has some sort of rumble. I'm not sure.
Like a camera shake.
I don't know, because I don't think they've used it that much, but I swear in one of the games, like, something brushed my face.
Maybe it just hit you.
I feel it, like, maybe something just hit me, but I don't know. Maybe my girlfriend was messing with me, be like, ooh.
Maybe she was. Maybe you would have no idea, man, in the VR. You're locked in.
I have no idea.
The VR looks crazy. I've seen, you should check out, like, the climbing game that's by CryEngine or Crytek or whatever. And, look, it's like mountain climbing in VR. But so it's really immersive because you got your Vive controller and you like climb up, like hold it, I guess.
And you got to like hammer in the loop and thread your rope through and stuff.
Yeah, you got to do all that kind of stuff. You got to navigate. Like it's like a crazy fantasy almost world of mountains or whatever.
I should try that. What's that called? Do you know?
No. Search like
that's the thing. I'm searching through these just mountains of VR games. Like and you.
Oh, I know.
You can sort by user reviews, but you know sometimes the user reviews don't always reflect the quality of the game. I mean, most of the time they do, but, you know, I'm trying to find those hidden gems.
Yeah, I have no doubt that there are, and I know there's going to be so many coming out.
Oh, yeah.
Like, this is kind of the first E3 where there's been, or there will be, VR as a thing, like commercially available VR.
Oh, yeah.
So, I'm excited to see what all the press conferences coming up tomorrow and the next day and the day after that.
I'm so excited, man. I can't wait for the future of the virtual reality game, especially because I have one. I mean, it's nice when you've got one. But
yeah, that's definitely a good feeling,
definitely nice. So you'll definitely have to try it out sometime.
Yeah.
Okay, buddy, what have you been playing this week?
So I barely had any time to play any video games, so I think I played maybe an hour or two of The Witcher. More.
Blood and Wine?
Yeah.
Still loving it?
Still loving it. Still just questing along, doing side quests, and I try to, like, I always do the lowest level cap mission.
Right.
As soon as, that's, like, the next one on my list, right?
Okay.
So.
Like, you don't ever skip.
No, I don't skip, and I won't, like, do the story until I've done all the side quests that are lower level than that story quest.
Gotcha.
So that's kind of, like, the pacing I go at.
Right. So you play 100% of the game.
Well, no, I do all the quests and stuff, I don't find all the hidden bullshit. Oh,
okay, yeah.
That's, I think, filler for games. But I do all the quests. And, yeah, they're good. Like, they're still good. The quote-unquote problem is that the side quests are so full of detail and full of story, and each side quest is like a main quest in some games, that I'm, as a person who only had an hour or two this week.
Shit, I finished one side quest.
Yeah, like, I'm like, oh, I haven't played any of this game yet.
Well, no, that's kind of good. I mean, if you enjoy the side quests at least, then
yeah,
then at least it's, you don't mind spending the time.
No. And one thing this E3 so far already has made me realize, just looking at the graphical fidelity of the games they're announcing, especially the ones for PC, I'm like, I'm going to buy that new graphics card probably the day it comes out.
If you're a PC gamer, that's got to be your life, man. And I'm sure it is, but like, you got to have the nice graphics cards to be...
Yeah.
Because I when I got this new one for the VR, I tried it out on some of the older games, and you can notice a difference. Like, I used to be able to run The Witcher on like medium to low settings.
Yeah.
But with this new card, I can run it on ultra.
Yeah, you can probably max it out, eh?
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah, we both just looked over our shoulder. That was interesting. If you're watching on YouTube, you'll notice that Garrett and I both just looked at whatever was going on behind us.
What the hell's going on back there?
And it almost looked like we looked at the same spot on the camera.
Oh, yeah. Here, I'll just look over at you, Josh. What's up, man?
Hey, Garrett. How's it going?
Yeah. What's up?
No, but...
12 episodes in and we haven't done that yet. Done that look at each other thing.
Yeah, that is awful.
That's the quality of our content right there. We're focused on the content, not fucking around with the cameras.
Yeah.
I'm going to just switch us around this time just to make it look like we're looking the other way.
No, don't do that, man. The fans will be like, what the hell is going on?
That's like, these idiots.
Who are these guys? They're not in their normal place. They can't be the same guys.
Well, we can talk a little bit about another thing that happened this week is that NBA 2K16 was free for one day only.
Was that announced or was it just
I don't know. I heard about it from a friend of mine who said, hey, man, you got to get NBA 2K16, it's free today on the PlayStation Store only. So I downloaded it. I was like, yeah, no question. Free game.
Yeah.
Especially NBA 2K16, I wanted it.
That's so, like, still a new game.
Yeah. No. Yeah, I was like, this is great. And I played the My Player, the career mode.
That's with the Spike Lee, right?
Spike Lee. That's right. We talked about it in another episode when I was playing NBA 2K15. But now I'm playing 2K16, so I can talk about it.
Yeah.
It, in my opinion, it's garbage.
Ah, okay.
Why? Sorry, Spike. But
just like, because they don't need it?
Well, no, it's just like, okay, so in past My Career modes, and it makes sense, when you get drafted in the NBA, they give you the whole 82-game calendar, and you play through those games.
Right.
You play the games. All the games. And I mean, some people found that to be too many games.
See, I'm one of the people that find that's right? too grindy. Like, if I'm playing the My Career for the story that they've included, then I don't want to play every fucking game.
No, and I
but
get
if
that.
I'm playing, like, my PGM, I want to, like, play every game.
Right. So, the adjustment that they made in NBA 2K15 was they added story elements paced throughout. So, you might play two or three games, and then you get a story thing crop up. You know, you'd get an endorsement that would get you a bunch of XP that you could add to your attributes, which made you want to go and play the games because you just got a boost to your skills.
Right.
Like, say you added a bunch more to your three-point shot because you got a sponsorship with Sprite. So then you hop in the game, you want to shoot some threes to see if you can notice a difference. And you can.
Good.
Right? And that's having all those games allows you to earn the experience to level up. That's why NBA 2K15 did it so well, because as soon as you're getting bored... You're like, I've played three or four games, then they'll throw in something that'll go, oh, okay, I'll get a bunch of experience. Now I'm reinvested.
Even better.
Right, I'm reinvested. NBA 2K16, after every game, one game, there's a long, like, 10-minute cutscene.
Oh, really?
Pretty much every time. And
that's yikes.
It's like, at the beginning, I was like, okay, I don't mind adding story to a sports game. But then towards the end, I'm like, I'm halfway through the NBA season, and I've played four games.
So wait, you just like, you'll play a game, it'll cut to story, and then it'll like, it'll be like 7 months later.
Yeah, it'll be like context. So it'll be like, first game was my first NBA game. Second game was my first time back to my hometown of New York.
Third game. So they've like picked like milestone events in your career.
But there's only eight of them in your first year in the NBA.
You only play eight games.
You only play eight games of your rookie season. So you can't really win rookie of the year. Because they make you average, like, 6 points and 6 assists or whatever, like, your shit. I was like, what the fuck?
What if you, like, dominated in those 8 games? Are you still going to only average, like, 6 points every other game?
Yes. I scored, lame. Like, I had one game where I went off, and we were killing them, so coach kept me in.
Yeah.
So I just racked up 20 points, 10 assists. I had, like, 6 or 7 rebounds, too. Coach kept me in. It was, like, an epic game.
Nice.
But then next game, I was just, like, bench warmer, and over those games, it showed. Over the last 10 games, you know, so-and-so has averaged, you know, 6 points, 7 assists. You know, he's really distributed the ball well. I'm like, are you kidding me? I'm a star. Like, this is bogus.
I'm a superstar.
Yeah. And, you know, and it makes me wonder, you know, NBA 2K has been a franchise that has been a shining beacon of hope for career modes in sports games.
Well, sports games in general, it seems.
And now NHL hasn't announced what's going on. I didn't really like what I was seeing out of FIFA. It kind of reminded me of this NBA 2K.
That's what everyone is saying, that FIFA, the new, like, my career in FIFA looks just like that.
I know. It reminds me of that, and it's just like, come on, guys. 2K15 was an example of how you can do it well. It wasn't. There were definite problems. But, like, yeah. Do people not notice this and go, this is great. People love this. Or did people not love it? I don't know. That's, like,
yeah, they must that's what have. I don't get. Like, is that have. Like, I don't personally love the be a pro in any game, any sports game. I don't.
Right. No, and if you're not the type of player to play that mode, yeah, that's different. The people right. who play those modes, though, like, I'm a my player player. If I play any game, I play the my player. I want to be the star. I'm my ego. I want to be the best, right? And yeah, so in the NHL games, those used to be okay. Mm-hmm. Used to be okay because you just play the games. Okay,
right.
That's
and,
okay.
And occasionally the coach is like, you need to pass more or whatever.
Yeah. You know, but in NBA 2K15, it was like, okay, you can actually, if you accomplish things in the game, it'll give you endorsements that will get you more skills. There's purpose to what you're doing in the games.
Right.
If you average a certain amount of points, you'll earn MVP, which will earn you another endorsement, which will get you more skills, and you'll progress through. It made sense. But this Spike Lee thing, and what looks like they're trying to do with this FIFA thing is your journey, you know, like the My Journey thing or whatever.
Yeah, they're trying to get, like,
to script it for you.
And it's very emotionally engaging, they're trying to get.
Right. Which is like, okay, so. It's fine. There's one story to be, okay, yeah, like, you're a guy who, you know, maybe you were poor and you grew up in the projects and you came up and now you're a star. Like, okay, that's one story. But what about the guy who's just a rich white kid who, you know, like, I don't know.
Owns a lot of FIFA or NBA games.
Yeah, like, what about the other stories? Like, I don't know. It just...
Yeah.
Anyways, that's just me ranting about sports games.
No, I get that. What else did you play? It says you played The Lab on the Vive.
I did play on the Vive. The Lab was decent. Again, it's an arcade game.
What do you mean,
like,
arcade?
It's like a demo, pretty much.
Oh, yeah,
just for
what
the VR can do. But the best part of it was there's a bow and arrow thing where it's like a tower defense where you shoot the arrows. And it works really well. I mean, it's kind of hard to aim because, like, the drop, like, you're actually shooting a bow and arrow.
Right.
So, like...
Right, you have to factor in...
I know, if I was shooting a real bow and arrow, I would suck. Like, I couldn't hit anything.
Man, so, I think that would be...
You know, you can kind of hit these things, but...
I think there's so much potential for VR because of how, like, incredibly immersive it is. Like, think about the game For Honor by Ubisoft. Mm. That crazy, over-the-top medieval warfare, gory blood and guts and stuff. Imagine that in VR.
So that would work, like, incredibly well with VR.
Right, because you also have your, like, weapons. You could have, like, 2 axes, let's say, and you're just, like, hacking and slashing.
Now, that's a more of a multiplayer-focused game, right? And the VR VR multiplayer for combat-style games, it's going to be really tough for them to do.
Hmm.
Like, it's really only if you're in a vehicle where they can affect your speed and things like that, can they really monitor? Because if you're doing a combat game like For Honor, where you swing your weapons around and stuff, you get, like... Like, you know what you would do if you had the VR. You know, swing
the
sword.
Yeah, like spam it or whatever.
You just spam, just like you would just press the button. But there's no way to control it in the VR, right?
Right.
So, like, when you're playing the computer, you can totally dominate them. It's fine. Or you can make them block certain attacks. But when it's a player, it's much harder to control.
Right. It would be a lot... I mean, if they got it right, kind of, like, cheating-wise, then it would be a lot harder to play. Like, I think everyone... It'd be hard to kill someone Because it would feel very much like you're trying to kill them.
I know.
And they're trying to defend themselves.
Like, it's pretty real at that point. Yeah. You're like, okay, thrusting a sword through someone.
Yeah, like, I'm a big fan. Not a big fan. Like, I don't love the stuff. But when a game does, like, a lot of gore or, like, over-the-top violence, I don't mind. Because I know it's a video game, and that's, like, what video games offer, is that.
Yeah, but this VR is something that can give you nightmares, man. Like, it's so... I got scared even in this RPG game. Like, I heard an enemy coming around the corner for the first time. And, like, he stabbed me. Like, he got me at one point.
Yeah.
And it scared the shit out of me.
Yeah.
Because I'm so immersed in this game, I look down, and my body's not there. There's no body there.
So I'm like, not yet.
I'm like, oh, fuck. But, like, he had put the sword right under my camera.
Yeah.
Right into where my chest would be. So I'm like, oh! Like, I was like, I even tried to, oh!
Jump out of the way.
So like, oh! And I was like, it scared me. I was like, oh, shit.
I know, man. Can you, like, there are horror games already.
I know, and I'm not playing them because I will get nightmares, man.
I'm with you on that. I'm not going to be playing any VR horror games.
I'm sorry. I just, and for people who like horror games, I'm sure this is going to be great for you, but if you like scared, I would literally shit my pants. Like, I'm so scared.
Yeah, dude, I get scared at movies, and I can even just sit there and tell myself, it's only a movie, it's only a movie. As soon as it's VR, and I'm like...
Well, like, you've got this thing on your head, right? You've got this thing on your head, and so you hear something happening behind you.
Yeah.
In a video game, like, you turn the camera around. But in this, the camera's your head. So you're like, you don't really want to look at it.
Yeah, you're like, I don't actually want to
look. You're like, oh, gosh, I don't want to look. Oh, God, oh! So it's just, oh, it's funny. No, it's a lot of fun. That's a lot of fun. I'm looking forward to the future.
I'm excited to see what they do with it, man. Like, imagine a year from now, episode 64, 52 weeks from now, the VR titles you're going to be talking about.
Yeah.
What I played this week.
What I played this week, I completely dominated an entire tribe of cavemen.
Dude, that reminds me. Maybe a potential hype zone thing, but there is a game called Before. It's just called Before. And from what I've seen of their development blogs, it's like super early in development still. But from what I've seen, it's like a caveman, I think a top-down sort of like almost RTS game.
Right.
But you like kind of you have your tribe and they grow in number and you have to settle the area and hunt for food and forage the land and prevent fires and all that, like the regular settlement building stuff. But instead of being in like a medieval or a whatever era, it's in
times.
It's prehistoric times.
Right.
So it looks amazing and the art is really cool, so we'll hype that up soon.
So is it an RTS or is it a sandbox? Like a city builder type thing?
Look, I think it's a bit of both.
Oh, okay.
Like you, I think
so
you
like a civilization type, like 4X game maybe. Like you build up your tribe and.
Well, not quite that scale, but.
Yeah, but.
But in pre. Yeah.
You build like, a city and you go to war.
Yeah, and I think you can get like new technology, which would be like fire.
the wheel. Invented the wheel.
Yeah.
You right now have a cart to carry dead bodies back. Health up. Health upgraded one.
Yeah. Metal tools. The Bronze Age.
Yeah. Oh, that's great.
But it looked cool. We'll hype that. Because they have a bunch of development blogs, so.
Awesome.
We'll go through
You know what?
That.
We'll save that. For our fans out there, there's no hype zone this week because it's E3, man. We spent the whole half of the show hyping. You don't get enough hype, just go back and listen to the first part of the show again.
Plus, I'm waiting for the big. What's that?
We'll be back next week with plenty of hype. It might be a fully dedicated episode to just hype from all the news that's come out this week. I think that makes sense.
I think that's what we should do next week.
What is EA screwing up and still hype up what's going on this week?
Yeah, I think. Like, I'm waiting to hear about, like, what's the big E3 news that there's always like at least one game, you know?
Yeah.
So that we can probably hype zone next week.
Well, let's hope it comes. Like, let's hope this isn't the year that E3 doesn't have a shock moment, you know?
Yeah.
Let's hope we get something still.
I agree.
I mean, it hasn't even started yet, and we're... like, it hasn't even really started yet.
That's true.
But I'm worried.
I hope Red Dead Redemption 2 gets announced. I don't even think that's, like, a possibility, but I can still hope.
Okay, predictions right now.
Oh, predictions.
Predictions.
Oh, I don't have many. Nintendo
still has to do their stuff.
Okay, Legend of Zelda.
Rockstar still has to do their stuff.
Does they have a conference?
I don't know what they're doing. I don't know. We just have to hear from them, right?
I don't think they're big enough, but yeah, maybe. Who knows? They might not have a conference, anything.
But they might have. They probably won't have a presentation, but they'll have stuff there to announce, I'm sure.
That's right. That's right, yeah.
Nintendo hasn't done their... I don't know that they're at E3. I think they're doing their own thing.
I think they have their press conference. But they might do their own thing.
They haven't done it yet. We're not exactly educated, but we're... Because there's so much...
I'm going to learn as it goes.
There's just so much stuff happening to people. And I'm sure as fans out there, you're looking through all this stuff going, what is going on? Like, there's so much stuff, so much news about all these games, right? It's almost overwhelming.
Yeah. If you go on the Reddit... like our games forum, it is just E3 posts only right now.
Yeah.
And it's just trailer after trailer after trailer.
And it's just
after
too
a little
much,
bit
right?
of news.
It's kind of overwhelming for fans. So hopefully next week's episode, we can kind of, we'll comb through it all for you guys. And then we can come back and kind of talk about each thing that you guys are looking forward to, that we're looking forward to, just kind of settle down the dust of what happens at E3.
Yeah.
But as far as this episode, I think we're pretty much finished. We hyped up kind of some of the stuff that happened already. We're looking forward to E3 next week. Talked about the Vive a little bit. EA's big screw up, our Steam picks of the week. Definitely go check those out.
Yep.
But Josh, I got to thank you for being here with me.
Thank you, Garrett. It was a blast, man. We should totally do this again.
Yeah, it's funny you say that, because we definitely will, because we always do.
We always
Episode 12,
do.
Folks. The Episode Baker's 12. Dozen.
Not a regular dozen.
Regular dozen of episodes. But for our listeners out there, I got to thank you guys so much for listening. If you stuck all the way through this episode, we appreciate it so much. Thank you. You guys are the reason why we do this show. For any of our listeners out there, any of our viewers on YouTube, listeners on iTunes, SoundCloud, on the Sky Gaming site, thank you so much. And we'll continue to bring you as good content as we can. So thank you again. And we hope to see you guys next time on Video Games.